Coach, what do you attribute to the sustained success despite lineup changes and, you know, sometimes shorthanded lineups?
I mean, you know, I don't think there's any one thing I would, you know, after being one of the people that watched from afar, I would say, you know, like, our culture is really strong right now. I think there's a strong belief amongst our players and our coaches that people know how to play, how we want to play, and our systems, like our style of play, has been building over the last couple of years. And I think, you know, there's been a lot of adversity, and I think our players' ability to, and coaches for that matter, ability to just kind of focus on what's in front of us and not let the big picture get to us. You know, I think once you go through it a little bit, we started to, I mean, we really have for the whole year, but we really, this last month's been super challenging. And I think once we saw that we could still play the way we wanted to, it gave the players a lot of confidence. And I know for myself, I had a lot of confidence that the team was going to be able to perform the way they know how.
Coach, when the team's on a roll like this, do things come a little bit easier for you guys?
Well, I mean, I think, you know, like, I think that's a two-pronged question. Yes, it seems that way, but I also think it's human nature to get a little complacent, and I think, you know, from my standpoint, making sure that we stay focused on the things that are fundamental to the way we play. And sometimes it's, you know, it's easy to just kind of think you're going to roll on the adrenaline. And I think one of the more challenging things over the last couple of weeks, especially since we played UConn, is just lack of practice time. You know, we've had people in and out, one coach at practice with 14 players, stuff like that. And so I think getting back to after this past weekend, having all our staff at practice and having a full complement of players, or at least how the players that we're going to have here until the Olympics are over, I think for me, like, gets us grounded back to the things that we're doing well. But certainly it makes for a good vibe at practice and around the team, which is you can't manufacture that.
Did some of the responsibility
You know, interestingly, we talked to the captains about that this week, and I think that they were quick to deflect the credit that I was trying to give them in a weekly meeting that we have with the captains, and I think they're right to some extent, but I think the leadership that they brought on the ice, you see the big goals that Shanahan scored, and Teresa Schaffsall's just been on a roll. I don't think that can be overstated for sure, but I do think that, you know, we've worked really hard on the culture, and it's a buzzword and it's hard to pin it down and define it exactly. But, you know, I know that, you know, when I left Worcester on Tuesday morning of last week, I was very confident that the team knew how to play. And I think that goes for everybody, and, you know, like our medical staff was instrumental in that, our equipment manager, we had a skeleton crew down there for that second game. So, I mean, you can't have it without good leadership, but I think having a good team makes those leaders not have to come down on people, and you know, people are easily led, I guess I should say. They're leading themselves in some respects.
What did you see from Coach Gattins going in?
Calmness more than anything. I can't think of a time that I've ever really coached a game by myself. And obviously that first game, we got a quick lead down at Holy Cross, and we were up 4-0 after one. And I think that was a little bit of a different situation than what we had with the Providence. The Providence games, where they didn't play the previous weekend. They were very well prepared for us, and we really didn't have any time. We didn't have any practice time. We played Monday, Tuesday, took Wednesday off, had a quick practice on Thursday, and here we are playing again. And I think you know, I was in communication with him, as was Coach Kazumi, in between periods. But every time I saw him on the computer, he looked calm and in control. And I think that was probably the most important thing that he could convey to the team, that, hey, we got this. We know what we're doing. Let's just stick to it.
What was that Tuesday like, having to go home? Did you watch that performance live?
I did. I got home in time to watch it. I had rented a car and made sure that I got home in time to watch it. And I'm not going to lie. I think my first communication to Alex after the first period was that Jess and I had decided that we weren't going to attend any more games. That if I am not kidding, that was the first text message to Alex, was like, hey, I mean, clearly you guys don't need us. So obviously that's not the case, but it was a bizarre game. That was the first game in my entire career that I've missed. I kind of skipped over being a D1 assistant, where you sometimes miss games to go recruiting, and I had never had an occasion to miss a game either as a D3 assistant or a D3 head coach. So that was 652 games in a row. So it was really weird feeling. But it was great to come back, I can tell you that. I thought that I missed it until I got back on the ice with these guys, and then I realized even more how much I had missed it, which was really cool.
Kind of shifting gears a little bit, what would a win this weekend against Northeastern mean for this team?
Well, it would mean three really important points, and I know that's probably cliche, and I think there's a psychological boost that it would give us. I feel like we've competed well with them the four games we've played with them over the past year, two last year, two this year. I think we've taken some confidence out of our ability to skate with them and compete and create some quality scoring chances. To be able to finish the job would be good. I mean, you know, they're the benchmark in our league right now. The bar is set with them, and it has been for the last few years. So I think being able to finally, you know, put enough pucks in the net and play a complete game would be a huge boost of confidence, you know, to go down the home stretch and then the playoffs are a month away or a little less.
What did you learn from the first two meetings
against Northeastern? I don't think I learned anything that we hadn't seen from them over the last couple of years, but that was a weekend where we were missing four players at the Olympic qualifiers. So we didn't play that great in the first period, and we played very well for the five other periods there. So I think, you know, if we were looking at that first time where we had a little hint of what was to come in January with roster shuffling and the ability to have different people step up and continue to be able to execute the way we want, I think that was probably the most important thing. Like, hey, obviously we'd rather have Teresa Schaffsall in the lineup than not. We've seen what an impact that she has, and Natalie Milinkova as well, and Tinka and Tony Matzker were also out that for that series. But I think that was really a great glimpse of maybe a preview of what we were going to have to go through for other reasons, starting, you know, when we came back from break.
Do you have any thoughts on the change of format of the Hockey East now being points percentage?
I literally just saw that on my phone before I came up here. I don't think with only it impacting a few teams and a few games, I haven't really looked at how it could impact us. But I've said to the team, I think this is it's way too early for us to be looking at who's playing who and how many games are left. I think if we just keep winning the games in front of us, then it's going to benefit us. I mean, obviously Northeastern's got a huge lead, but I think, second place is right there for the taking. You know, UConn is continuing to play well, and I'm sure they're looking at it the same way. So, I like where we are right now, and if we keep winning, then people can't catch us. That's really the bottom line. Points percentage-wise, points-wise, any way you look at it. Well, I mean, it's a good question, because at the beginning, you know, she's always been dripping with skill, And at the beginning, she was a super high-risk player, and we got a lot of the – we got some rewards, but we got you know, the plus-minus and some of the more advanced analytics that we look at were not favorable. The net impact wasn't as great as it is right now. It's not just the points. So there's a couple things. One is the way she's playing allows her to play in the offensive zone a lot. All right, so she's quarterbacking the team, and we spend a lot of time in the offensive zone when she's on the ice. So nothing. We're not going to give up goals. She's not going to get minuses. We're not spending a lot of time and energy on defending. So I think that's one really obvious thing. But I think just her overall completeness as a player has really risen leaps and bounds over this year. And we've worked hard with her to try to get her to understand the game and understand where to take risks and understand, you know, how important it is to be responsible defensively with this sort of rhetorical question: can you play good defense without sacrificing anything on the offensive end? And you know, she's a student of the game. She likes to learn. She likes to watch video. She likes to talk about it. And it's paid off. And obviously, it's paid off at the offensive end in spades so far.